folks. Come on in for a visit.
Welcome, everybody. This is my home, and I've had it for 21 years. I bought it when nobody even knew or cared what these were, and now we've come a long way and we know a lot more about what they are. So this was built by the Alexander Construction Company. Their architect was William Krisel.
So the Alexanders came to Palm Springs in the mid-50s, I think about 56, basically for health reasons. And at that time, there was no, they had been tract home builders in the San Fernando Valley, and that really wasn't going on here, a very, very small scale. So they saw an opportunity, and they reached out to William Krisel, who actually had designed just a small amount of homes, maybe about 10 or 15 in the San Fernando Valley for them, but they had sold incredibly well, very quickly, and they made the most money off of those homes because he kind of showed them how to make money. So they came down here. The first thing they did is they built the Ocotillo Lodge, which was a hotel. The interesting thing about it is at the time, Palm Springs was a bit restrictive, and the Ocotillo was the first place that Jewish people could stay at and dine and all that sort of thing, because the Alexanders were Jewish. They then worked with Krisel to build homes that were really patterned on their house in Brentwood, the post and beam style, with tongue and groove ceilings, sun flaps, atriums in the house, that sort of thing. They said, we want you to take everything that is in your house and incorporate it in these new Palm Springs houses. So there were 9 elevations done, 2 basic floor plans that were rotated and different roof lines to create essentially a custom look. And they sold like hotcakes because obviously there must have been demand for this product. They weren't cheap. They were like about $32,000, which in those days was a lot of money, but Palm Springs actually was a little bit of an expensive place. So the homes basically catered to the well-to-do, captains of industry. I mean, there was a vice president of U.S. Steel, people from Purina Cat Chow, doctors, lawyers, that sort of thing, who were making their first kind of purchase in the desert as a second home. They were, again, unique because they all looked custom, and so they were able to basically make a lot of money by offering a product that was common amongst with all the different components, but yet looked custom to the buying public.
By sliding these open, you can bring the outdoors in.
Bugs and all.
So here we are outdoors, and this is the original swimming pool. It's pretty much unchanged, and this exact pool was installed in all the houses. They all came, included a pool for that $32,000. The roof line, you can really see the butterfly roof line very well from here. And then my other ideas of trying to bring indoors, outdoors was with these containers, these pots, and they were all done by a very famous company that went out of business in the early 80s, but started in the mid 50s, called Architectural Pottery. And they were the first company to really kind of address using planting containers for modern houses, because before then everything was kind of a little bit Romanesque. And so they had all kinds of designers create these incredible forms and shapes, and they're back in production again, but the originals are highly sought after. Most of these are original.
So after I bought the house, my decision that guided me on how to furnish it was I would just look at anything that was available from 1957 back that anybody could have bought. And while furniture has changed over the last 20 years, I've gotten rid of some things I've had since I bought the house. That was always the driving design element, because I wanted to kind of replicate what I thought people did. But then in looking later at magazine articles that were, or photographs that I just found of these interiors, nobody did it. Everybody was very traditional. They're either decorators or they were. So it was actually kind of rare that people bought all this stuff, but they could have bought every bit of it because it was all pretty much available at that time. The exception is the house that a Krisel designed for the Alexanders themselves in this neighborhood. He designed the entire interior and actually designed some couches and end tables for them, and that house was thoroughly modern, and it kind of looks like this. most of it is kind of brand name things, manufacturers like Noel and Herman Miller, basically because they were still making this stuff from that era. It really never left their production. And also because I liked it. The designers were people like Saarinen and Florence Knoll. This chair I'm sitting in is by Arne Jacobsen, a Dane who designed this in that year, 1957, for the SAS Royal Hotel in Copenhagen.
In contrast to these biomorphic pieces is this table, which is one of my favorites. It's by Louis Butler, who was a protege for Florence Knoll, and it's very rectilinear and formal, but yet it's also playful because it has the black and white checkerboard top. And it's an interesting mix of sort of formal walnut base, but the top is new for then for mica plastic, and the mixing of those two materials, I think, is also indicative of that era. The sofa is by Florence Knoll, and again, you can see it plays very well with this table because it's extremely rectilinear and very formal and stylized and almost just a perfect example of what I think a sofa should be. So this is my bedroom, and I thought this is the perfect space to talk about what was a really a big thing for not only Krisel, but also most mid-century architects during that era, is the concept of connecting the indoors and the out, to where walls of glass are essentially really meant to be disappeared, and indoors sort of comes in. And so in this room, we have a huge amount of clerestory windows that let you look up to the sky and see the palms. And there are some mountains way in the distance there that maybe you can't see beyond. And then this large wall of glass and the wing wall that kind of extends out to the brick painted in the same color that draws your eye so that you do make that visual connection and there's a seamlessness to inside and outside. So another way that Krisel brought the indoors into the house is this really super cool feature. It's an atrium. He called it a sun trap. And it's basically now bringing the outdoors into the room. So it's kind of a luxury wasted space, but I love that it brings natural light and you can plant it and, you know, make another connection to Mother Nature. And at night it's really lovely because it's lit with kind of a colored light and it's almost like moonlight. So it's functions as almost another lamp, if you will. And speaking of lighting, I like also how he integrated that. Above the door is very much like Richard Neutra or Frank Lloyd Wright would integrate lighting into the features of the house, the architectural deep features of the house. So as I mentioned earlier, this house is a Class 1 historic site on the city of Palm Springs, as evidenced by this very fine plaque that the city gave me. And that's because it's a fairly accurate, pure representation of the original house, as evidenced by the colors of the house, which are also original. And that was a three-part process to get them all correct. The brown, that's painting out the wood trim is still in production. Dunn Edwards, weathered brown, it's exactly what Krisel specified in his list of colors. The green I found in a storage locker here that had never been overpainted and have that matched. And then the white is off-white from the O'Brien Paint Company, long out of business, but that's the company he used, and I found the paint chips on eBay and had that matched. The carport is open, and a lot of people close them off. I love them open because, and so did the architect, obviously, that designed them. They didn't like closed garages because it gave almost more weight to this part of the house where the cars are than the house. It was so when you open it up, it becomes this very light, sort of see-through, transparent thing. And I like it because you can put beautiful cars, and they sort of act as sculpture to the whole street tableau. And then finally, Krisel created this landscaping in 2006, but it is really based on the way he was thinking in the mid-50s. He learned from the great landscape architect Garrett Ekpo. So it has a lot of that influence. It's kind of very painterly. It looks sort of like a Mondrian painting if you look at it from higher up. Like when the double-deck buses come by and during Modernism Week, you really get a great view of it. So here we have another view of the landscaping. And as you can see, it's quite dramatic. And that is the national bird of Palm Springs. And it's almost extinct, but obviously it's still, we have a few examples. From the mailbox, you kind of see these dots lead you into this incredible grove of very ancient palm trees that probably were planted when the house was first done. The lighting is really great. I encourage you to come by at night. These flying saucer objects are all lit up. It's colored glass, but they're kind of super cool. So yeah, come by at night.
Down among the sheltering palms, oh honey, wait for me, honey, wait for me. Don't be forgetting we've got a day out where the sun goes down about 8. How my love is burning, burning, burning. How my heart is yearning, yearning, yearning to be down among the sheltering palms. Oh, honey, wait for me.